This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. The New Deal was a series of social liberal programs enacted in the United States between 1933 and 1938, and a few that came later. They included both laws passed by Congress as well as presidential executive orders during the first term 1933 to 1937 of President Franklin D. Roosevelt. The programs were in response to the Great Depression, and focused on what historians refer to as the three rupees: relief, recovery, and reform. Relief for the unemployed and poor, recovery of the economy to normal levels, and reform of the financial system to prevent a repeat depression. The New Deal produced a political realignment, making the Democratic Party the majority as well as the party that held the White House for 7 out of 9 presidential terms from 1933 to 1969. With its base in liberal ideas, the South, traditional Democrats, big city machines, and the newly empowered labor unions and ethnic minorities, the Republicans were split, with conservatives opposing the entire New Deal as an enemy of business and growth, and liberals accepting some of it and promising to make it more efficient. The realignment crystallized into the New Deal coalition that dominated most presidential elections into the 1960s, while the opposing conservative coalition largely controlled Congress from 1939 to 1964. By 1936, the term liberal typically was used for supporters of the New Deal, and conservative for its opponents from 1934 to 1938. Roosevelt was assisted in his endeavors by a pro-spender majority in Congress drawn from two party, competitive, non-machine, progressive, and left. Party districts as noted by Alexander Hicks, Roosevelt, backed by rare, non-Southern Democrat majorities, 270 non-Southern Democrat representatives and 71 non-Southern Democrat senators, spelled Second New Deal reform. In the 1938 midterm elections, however, Roosevelt and his liberal supporters lost control of Congress to the bipartisan conservative coalition. Many historians distinguish between a First New Deal 1933-34 and a Second New Deal 1935-38, with the second one more liberal and more controversial. The First New Deal 1933-34 dealt with the pressing banking crises through the Emergency Banking Act and the 1933 Banking Act. The Federal Emergency Relief Administration provided $500. And the Fair Labor Standards Act of 1938, which set maximum hours and minimum wages for most categories of workers. The economic downturn of 1937-38, and the bitter split between the AFL and CIO labor unions led to major Republican gains in Congress in 1938. Conservative Republicans and Democrats in Congress joined in the informal conservative coalition. By 1942-43, they shut down relief programs such as the WPA and CCC and blocked major liberal proposals. Roosevelt himself turned his attention to the war effort, and won re-election in 1940 and 1944. The Supreme Court declared the National Recovery Administration NRA and the first version of the Agricultural Adjustment Act AAA unconstitutional. However, the AAA was rewritten and then upheld as the first Republican president elected after FDR. Dwight D. Eisenhower 1953-61 left the New Deal largely intact, even expanding it in some areas in the 1960s. Lyndon B. Johnson's Great Society used the New Deal as inspiration for a dramatic expansion of liberal programs, which Republican Richard M. Nixon generally retained after 1974. However, the call for deregulation of the economy gained bipartisan support. The New Deal regulation of banking Glass-Steagall Act was suspended in the 1990s. Many New Deal programs remain active, with some still operating under the original names, including the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation FDIC, the Federal Crop Insurance Corporation FCIC, the Federal Housing Administration FHA, and the Tennessee Valley Authority. TVA. The largest programs still in existence today are the Social Security System and the Securities and Exchange Commission SEC. Contents 1. Origins 11. Economic Collapse 1929-1933-12. New Deal 1933-1938-2. First New Deal 1933-1934-21. The First 100 Days 1933-211. Fiscal Policy 212. Banking Reform 213. Monetary Reform 214. Securities Act of 1933-215. Repeal of Prohibition 22. Relief 221. Public Works 222. Farm and Rural Programs 23. Recovery 231. NRA Blue Eagle Campaign. 232 Housing Sector 24 Reform 241 Trade Liberalization 242 Puerto Rico 3 Second New Deal 1935-1938-31 Social Security Act 32 Labor Relations 33 Works Progress Administration 34 Tax Policy 35 Housing Act of 1937 4 Court Packing Plan and Jurisprudential Shift 5 Recession of 1937 and Recovery 6 World War II and Full Employment 61 Federal Budget Source 62 Wartime Welfare Projects 63 Fair Employment Practices 64 Growing Equality of Income 7 Legacy 8 Historiography and Evaluation of New Deal Policies 81 Fiscal Policy 82 Relief 83 Recovery 831 Keynesian Interpretation 832 Monetarist Interpretation 833 Economic Growth and Unemployment 1933-1941-834 Opinions on the Effect on the Depression 8341 Halted the Collapse but Lacked Keynesian Deficit Spending 8342 Cleared the Way for a Natural Recovery 8343 Crucial Source of Recovery 8344 Harmful 835 Austrian Interpretation 84 Reform 85 Impact on Federal Government and States 86 Race and Gender 861 African Americans 8611 Segregation 862 Women and the New Deal 9 Charges 91 Charges of Fascism 92 Charges of Conservatism 93 Communists in Government 10 Political Metaphor 11 Works of Art and Music 12 New Deal Programs 13 Statistics 131 Depression Statistics 132 Relief Statistics 14 See also 15 References 16 Further Reading 161 Surveys 162 State and Local Studies 163 Biographies. 164 Economics, Farms, Labor, Relief 165 Social and Cultural History 166 Politics 167 Primary Sources 17 External Links Origins The phrase New Deal was coined by an advisor to Roosevelt, Stuart Chase Economic Collapse 1929-1933 USA Annual Real GDP from 1910-1960, with the years of the Great Depression 1929-1939 highlighted unemployment rate in the U.S. 1910-1960, with the years of the Great Depression 1929-1939 highlighted, accurate data begins in 1939 from 1929-1933 manufacturing output decreased by one-third prices fell by 20%, causing deflation that made repaying debts much harder unemployment in the U.S. increased from 4% to 25% additionally, one-third of all employed persons were downgraded to working part-time on much smaller paychecks in the aggregate, almost 50% of the nation's human work power was going unused before the New Deal, there was no insurance on deposits at banks when thousands of banks closed, depositors lost their savings at that time there was no national safety net, no public unemployment insurance, and no social security relief for the poor was the responsibility of families, private charity, and local governments, but as conditions worsened year by year, demand skyrocketed and their combined resources increasingly fell far short of demand the depression had devastated the nation as Roosevelt took the oath of office at noon on March 4, 1933, all state governors had authorized bank holidays or restricted withdrawals, many Americans had little or no access to their bank accounts the unemployment rate was about 25% and higher in major industrial and mining centers farm income had fallen by over 50% since 1929 844,000 non-farm mortgages had been foreclosed, 1930-33, out of 5 million in all political and business leaders feared revolution and anarchy Joseph P. Kennedy Sr., who remained wealthy during the Depression, stated years later that, in those days I felt and said I would be willing to part with half of what I had if I could be sure of keeping, under law and order, the other half New Deal 1933-1938 Upon accepting the 1932 Democratic nomination for president, Franklin Roosevelt promised a New Deal for the American people throughout the nation men and women, forgotten in the political philosophy of the government, look to us here for guidance and for more equitable opportunity to share in the distribution of national wealth. I pledge myself to a New Deal for the American people. This is more than a political campaign, it is a call to arms. Roosevelt entered office without a specific set of plans for dealing with the Great Depression, so he improvised as Congress listened to a very wide variety of voices. Among Roosevelt's more famous advisors was an informal brain trust, a group that tended to view pragmatic government government intervention in the economy positively. His choice for Secretary of Labor, Frances Perkins, greatly influenced his initiatives. Her list of what her priorities would be if she took the job illustrates: a 40-hour workweek, a minimum wage, workers' compensation, unemployment compensation, a federal law banning child labor, direct federal aid for unemployment relief, Social Security, a revitalized public employment service, and health insurance. The New Deal policies drew from many different ideas proposed earlier in the 20th century. Assistant Attorney General Thurman Arnold led efforts that harkened back to an anti-monopoly tradition rooted in American politics by figures such as Andrew Jackson and Thomas Jefferson. Supreme Court Justice Louis Brandeis, an influential advisor to many New Dealers, argued that bigness, referring, presumably, to corporations, was a negative economic force, producing waste and inefficiency. However, the anti-monopoly group never had a major impact on New Deal policy. Other leaders such as Hugh S. Johnson of the NRA took ideas from the Woodrow Wilson administration, advocating techniques used to mobilize the economy for World War I. They brought ideas and experience from the government controls and spending of 1917-18. Other New Deal planners revived experiments suggested in the 1920s. Such as the TVA. The First New Deal 1933-34 encompassed the proposals offered by a wide spectrum of groups. Not included was the Socialist Party, whose influence was all but destroyed. This first phase of the New Deal was also characterized by fiscal conservatism, see Economy Act, below, and experimentation with several different, sometimes contradictory, cures for economic ills. The consequences were uneven. Some programs, especially the National Recovery Administration NRA and the Silver Program, have been widely seen as failures. Other programs lasted about a decade. Some became permanent. The economy shot upward, with FDR's first term marking one of the fastest periods of GDP growth in history, though a downturn in 1937-38 raised questions about just how successful the policies were. The great majority of economists and historians agree that they were an overall benefit. The New Deal faced some vocal conservative opposition. The first organized opposition in 1934 came from the American Liberty League, led by conservative Democrats such as 1924 and 1928. Presidential candidates John W. Davis and Al Smith. There was also a large but loosely affiliated group of New Deal opponents, who are commonly called the Old Right. This group included politicians, intellectuals, writers, and newspaper editors of various philosophical persuasions, including classical liberals and conservatives, both Democrats and Republicans. A number of leading Democrats, who were progressives of the Woodrow Wilson era, were also critical of Roosevelt's New Deal policies. According to James T. Patterson, these leaders were essentially progressives of the New Freedom vintage. They continued to believe that their party stood for Wilsonian ideals, regulated competition, states' rights, and individual freedom where it did not impinge upon the liberty of others, and saw themselves as the true progressives and as the bulwarks of a party which they felt would have collapsed without them. In the 1920s, the New Deal represented a significant shift in politics and domestic policy. It especially led to greatly increased federal regulation of the economy. It also marked the beginning of complex social programs and growing power of labor unions. The effects of the New Deal remain a source of controversy and debate among economists and historians. First New Deal 1933-1934-1935 cartoon by Von Shoemaker. He parodied the New Deal as a card game with alphabetical agencies. There were dozens of new agencies created by Roosevelt through executive orders. They are typically known by their alphabetical initials. The First 100 Days 1933 Main Article, First 100 Days of Franklin D. Roosevelt's Presidency. The American people were generally extremely dissatisfied with the crumbling economy, mass unemployment, declining wages and profits, and especially Hoover's policies such as the Smoot-Hawley Tariff Act and the Revenue Act of 1932. Roosevelt entered office with enormous political capital. Americans of all political persuasions were demanding immediate action, and Roosevelt responded with a remarkable series of new programs in the first 100 days of the administration, in which he met with Congress for 100 days. During those 100 days of lawmaking, Congress granted every request Roosevelt asked, and passed a few programs such as the FDIC to ensure bank accounts that he opposed. Ever since, presidents have been judged against FDR for what they accomplished in their first 100 days. Walter Lippmann famously noted, at the end end of February we were a congeries of disorderly panic-stricken mobs and factions. In the 100 days from March to June we became again an organized nation confident of our power to provide for our own security and to control our own destiny. The economy had hit bottom in March 1933 and then started to expand. Economic indicators show the economy reached nadir in the first days of March, then began a steady, sharp upward recovery. Thus the Federal Reserve Index of Industrial Production sank to its lowest point of 528 in July 1932 with 1,935-39=100 and was practically unchanged at 543 in March 1933. However, by July 1933, it reached 855, a dramatic rebound of 57% in 4 months. Recovery was steady and strong until 1937 except for employment. The economy by 1937 surpassed the levels of the late 1920s. The recession of 1937 was a temporary downturn. Private sector employment, especially in manufacturing, recovered to the level of the 1920s but failed to advance further until the war. The U.S. population was 124,840,471 in 1932 and 128,824,829 in 1937, an increase of 3,984,468. The ratio of these numbers times the number of jobs in 1932 means there was a need for 938,000 more 1937 jobs to maintain the same employment level. Fiscal policy. The Economy Act, drafted by Budget Director Lewis Williams Douglas, was passed on March 14, 1933. The act proposed to balance the regular non-emergency federal budget by cutting the salaries of government employees and cutting pensions to veterans by 15%. It saved $500. Deficits to fund his numerous programs. Douglas, however, rejecting the distinction between a regular and emergency budget, resigned in 1934 and became an outspoken critic of the New Deal. Roosevelt strenuously opposed the bonus bill that would give World War I veterans a cash bonus. Congress finally passed it over his veto in 1936, and the Treasury distributed $15. At the beginning of the Great Depression, the economy was destabilized by bank failures followed by credit crunches. The initial reasons were substantial losses in investment banking, followed by bank runs. Bank runs occurred when a large number of customers withdrew their deposits because they believed the bank might become insolvent as the bank run progressed. It generated a self-fulfilling prophecy. As more people withdrew their deposits, the likelihood of default increased, and this encouraged further withdrawals. Milton Friedman and Anna Schwartz have argued that the drain of money out of the banking system caused the monetary supply to shrink, forcing the economy to likewise shrink as credit and economic activity diminished. Price deflation followed, causing further economic contraction with disastrous impact on banks between 1929 and 1933. 40% of all banks, 9,490 out of 23,697 banks, failed. Much of the Great Depression's economic damage was caused directly by bank runs. Herbert Hoover had already considered a bank holiday to prevent further bank runs, but rejected the idea because he was afraid to trip a panic. Roosevelt, however, gave a radio address, held in the atmosphere of a fireside chat, and explained to the public in simple terms the causes of the banking crisis, what the government will do and how the population could help. He closed all the banks in the country and kept them all closed until he could pass new legislation on March 9, 1933. Roosevelt sent to Congress the Emergency Banking Act, drafted in large part by Hoover's top advisors. The act was passed and signed into law the same day. It provided for a system of reopening sound banks under Treasury supervision, with federal loans available if needed. Three-quarters of the banks in the Federal Reserve System reopened within the next 3 days. Billions of dollars in hoarded currency and gold flowed back into them within a month, thus stabilizing the banking system by the end of 1933. 4,004 small local banks were permanently closed and merged into larger banks. Their deposits totaled $36. Rates would have led to a gold outflow under the gold standards price specie flow mechanism. Countries that lost gold but nevertheless wanted to maintain the gold standard had to permit their money supply to decrease and the domestic price level to decline. Deflation. As long as the Federal Reserve had to defend the gold parity of the dollar, it had to sit idle while the banking system crumbled. In March and April, in a series of laws and executive orders, the government suspended the gold standard. Roosevelt stopped the outflow of gold by forbidding the export of gold except under license from the Treasury. Anyone holding significant amounts of gold coinage was mandated to exchange it for the existing fixed price of U.S. dollars. The Treasury no longer paid out gold in exchange for dollars, and gold would no longer be considered valid legal tender for debts in private and public contracts. The dollar was allowed to float freely on foreign exchange markets with no guaranteed price in gold. With the passage of the Gold Reserve Act in 1934, the nominal price of gold was changed from $2,067 per troy ounce to $35. These measures enabled the Federal Reserve to increase the amount of money in circulation to the level the economy needed. Markets immediately responded well to the suspension, in the hope that the decline in prices would finally end. In her essay, What Ended the Great Depression, 1992, Christina Romer argued that this policy raised industrial production by 25% until 1937 and by 50% until 1942. Securities Act of 1933. Before the Wall Street Crash of 1929, there was no regulation of securities at the federal level. Even firms whose securities were publicly traded published no regular reports, or even worse, rather misleading reports based on arbitrarily selected data to avoid another Wall Street crash. The Securities Act of 1933 was enacted. It required the disclosure of the balance sheet, profit and loss statement, the names and compensations of corporate officers, about firms whose securities were traded. Additionally, those reports had to be verified by independent auditors. In 1934, the U.S. Securities and Exchange Commission was established to regulate the stock market and prevent corporate abuses relating to the sale of securities and corporate reporting. Repeal of prohibition, in a measure that garnered substantial popular support for his New Deal, Roosevelt moved to put to rest one of the most divisive cultural issues of the 1920s. He signed the bill to legalize the manufacture and sale of alcohol, an interim measure pending the repeal of prohibition, for which a constitutional amendment of repeal the 21st was already in process. The repeal amendment was ratified later in 1933. States and cities gained additional new revenue, and Roosevelt secured his popularity, especially in the cities and ethnic areas, by helping the beer start flowing. Relief was the immediate effort to help the one-third of the population that was hardest hit by the Depression. Also, relief was aimed at providing temporary help to suffering and unemployed Americans. Public Works Administration Project, Bonneville Dam to prime the pump and cut unemployment. The NERA created the Public Works Administration PWA, a major program of public works, which organized and provided funds for the building of useful works such as government buildings, airports, hospitals, schools, roads, bridges, and dams. From 1933 to 1935, PWA spent $33. Rural America was a high priority for Roosevelt and his energetic Secretary of Agriculture, Henry A. Wallace. FDR believed that full economic recovery depended upon the recovery of agriculture, and raising farm prices was a major tool, even though it meant higher food prices for the poor living in cities. Many rural people lived in severe poverty, especially in the South. Major programs addressed to their needs included the Resettlement Administration RAW, the Rural Electrification Administration RAE, rural welfare projects sponsored by the WPA, National Youth Administration NYA, Forest Service and Civilian Conservation Corps CCC, including school lunches, building new schools, opening roads in remote areas, reforestation, and purchase of marginal lands to enlarge national forests. In 1933, the administration launched the Tennessee Valley Authority, a project involving dam construction planning on an unprecedented scale to curb flooding, generate electricity, and modernize poor farms in the Tennessee Valley region of the southern United States. Under the Farmers Relief Act of 1933, the government paid compensation to farmers who reduced output, thereby rising prices. As a result of this legislation, the average income of farmers almost doubled by 1937. In the 1920s, farm production had increased dramatically thanks to mechanization, more potent insecticides, and increased use of fertilizer. Due to an overproduction of agricultural products, farmers faced a severe and chronic agricultural depression throughout the 1920s. The Great Depression even worsened the agricultural crises. At the beginning of 1933, agricultural markets nearly faced collapse. Farm prices were so low that, as an example, in Montana wheat was rotting in the fields because it could not be profitably harvested. In Oregon, sheep were slaughtered and left to the buzzards because meat prices were not sufficient to warrant transportation to markets. Roosevelt was keenly interested in farm issues and believed that true prosperity would not return until farming was prosperous. Many different programs were directed at farmers the first 100 days produced the Farm Security Act to raise farm incomes by raising the prices farmers received, which was achieved by reducing total farm output. The Agricultural Adjustment Act created the Agricultural Adjustment Administration AAA in May 1933. The act reflected the demands of leaders of major farm organizations, especially the Farm Bureau, and reflected debates among Roosevelt's farm advisors such as Secretary of Agriculture Henry A. Wallace, M. L. Wilson, Rexford Tugwell, and George Peake. The AAA aimed to raise prices for commodities through artificial scarcity. The AAA used a system of domestic allotments, setting total output of corn, cotton, dairy products, hogs, rice, tobacco, and wheat. The farmers themselves had a voice in the process of using government to benefit their incomes. The AAA paid landowners subsidies for leaving some of their land idle, with funds provided by a new tax on food processing to force up farm prices to the point of parity. 10. Since then, but together with large subsidies, is still in effect in 2012. The Farm Tenancy Act in 1937 was the last major New Deal legislation that concerned farming. It, in turn, created the Farm Security Administration FSA, which replaced the Resettlement Administration. The Food Stamp Plan, a major new welfare program for urban poor, was established in 1939 to provide stamps to poor people who could use them to purchase food at retail outlets. The program ended during wartime prosperity in 1943, but was restored in 1961. It survived into the 21st century with little controversy because it was seen to benefit the urban poor, food producers, grocers and wholesalers, as well as farmers. Thus it gained support from both liberal and conservative congressmen in 2013. However, Tea Party activists in the House tried to end the program, now known as the Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program, while the Senate fought to preserve it. Recovery was the effort in numerous programs to restore the economy to normal health by most economic indicators. This was achieved by 1937, except for unemployment, which remained stubbornly high until World War II began. Recovery was designed to help the economy bounce back from depression. NRA Blue Eagle campaign. Main article, National Recovery Administration. NRA Blue Eagle. Roosevelt's advisors believed that excessive competition and technical progress had led to overproduction and lowered wages and prices, which they believed lowered demand and employment deflation. He argued that government economic planning was necessary to remedy this. A mere builder of more industrial plants, a creator of more railroad systems, an organizer of more corporations, is as likely to be a danger as a help. Our task is not necessarily producing more goods, it is the soberer, less dramatic business of administering resources and plants already in hand. From 1929 to 1933, the industrial economy had been suffering from a vicious cycle of deflation since 1931. The U.S. Chamber of Commerce, the voice of the nation's organized business, promoted an anti-deflationary scheme that would permit trade associations to cooperate in government-instigated cartels to stabilize prices within their industries, while existing antitrust laws clearly forbade such practices. Organized business found a receptive ear in the Roosevelt administration. New Deal economists argued that cutthroat competition had hurt many businesses, and that with prices having fallen 20% and more, deflation exacerbated the burden of debt and would delay recovery. They rejected a strong move in Congress to limit the workweek to 30 hours. Instead, their remedy, designed in cooperation with big business, was the NERA. It included stimulus funds for the WPA to spend, and sought to raise prices, give more bargaining power for unions so the workers could purchase more, and reduce harmful competition. At the center of the NERA was the National Recovery Administration (NRA), headed by former General Hugh S. Johnson, who had been a senior economic official in World War I. Johnson called on every business establishment in the nation to accept a stopgap blanket code, a minimum wage of between 20 and 45 cents per hour, a maximum workweek of 35 to 45 hours, and the abolition of child labor. Johnson and Roosevelt contended that the blanket code would raise consumer purchasing power and increase employment to mobilize political support for the NRA. Johnson launched the NRA Blue Eagle publicity campaign to boost what he called industrial self-government. The NRA brought together leaders in each industry to design specific sets of codes for that industry. The most important provisions were anti-deflationary floors below which no company would lower prices or wages, and agreements on maintaining employment and production in a remarkably short time. The NRA announced agreements from almost every major industry in the nation by March 1934. Industrial production was 45% higher than in March 1933. Donald Rickberg, who soon replaced Johnson as the head of the NRA, said, "There is no choice presented to American business between intelligently planned and Uncontrolled industrial operations and a return to the gold-plated anarchy that masqueraded as rugged individualism unless industry is sufficiently socialized by its private owners and managers so that great essential industries are operated under public obligation appropriate to the public interest in them. The advance of political control over private industry is inevitable. Manufacturing employment in the United States from 1920 to 1940. By the time NRA ended in May 1935, industrial production was 55% higher than in May 1933. In addition, well over 2. Housing sector. The New Deal had an important impact in the housing field. The New Deal followed and increased President Hoover's lead and seek measures. The New Deal sought to stimulate the private home building industry and increase the number of individuals who owned homes. The New Deal implemented 2 new housing agencies, Home Owners Loan Corporation HOLC and the Federal Housing Administration FHA. HOLC set uniform national appraisal methods and simplified the mortgage process. The Federal Housing Administration FHA created national standards for home construction. The New Deal helped increase the number of Americans who owned homes. Before the New Deal, only 4 out of 10 Americans owned homes. This was because the standard mortgage lasted only 5 to 10 years and had interest as high as 8%. These conditions severely limited the accessibility to housing for most Americans. Under the New Deal, Americans had access to 30-year mortgages, and the standardized appraisal and construction processes helped open up the housing market to many more Americans of that time. Reform was based on the assumption that the Depression was caused by the inherent instability of the market and that government intervention was necessary to rationalize and stabilize the economy, and to balance the interests of farmers, business and labor. Reforms targeted the causes of the Depression and sought to prevent a crisis like it from happening again. In other words, financially rebuilding the U.S. while ensuring not to repeat history. Trade liberalization. There is consensus amongst economic historians that protectionist policies, culminating in the Smoot-Hawley Act of 1930, worsened the Depression. Franklin D. Roosevelt already spoke against the act while campaigning for president during 1932. In 1934, the Reciprocal Tariff Act was drafted by Cordell Hull. It gave the president power to negotiate bilateral, reciprocal trade agreements with other countries. The act enabled Roosevelt to liberalize American trade policy around the globe. It is widely credited with ushering in the era of liberal trade policy that persists to this day. Puerto Rico. A separate set of programs operated in Puerto Rico, headed by the Puerto Rico Reconstruction Administration. It promoted land reform and helped small farms. It set up farm cooperatives, promoted crop diversification, and helped local industry. The Puerto Rico Reconstruction Administration was directed by Juan Pablo Montoya Sr. from 1935 to 1937. Second New Deal 1935 to 1938. See also, Second New Deal. In the spring of 1935, responding to the setbacks in the court, a new skepticism in Congress, and the growing popular clamor for more dramatic action, the administration proposed or endorsed several important new initiatives. Historians refer to them as the Second New Deal and note that it was more liberal and more controversial than the First New Deal of 1933-34. Social Security Act. A poster publicizing Social Security benefits. Until 1935, there were just a dozen states that had old age insurance laws, but these programs were woefully underfunded and therefore almost worthless. Just one state, Wisconsin, had an insurance program. The United States was the only modern industrial country where people faced the Depression without any national system of Social Security. Even the work programs of the First New Deal were just meant as immediate relief, destined to run less than a decade. The most important program of 1935, and perhaps the New Deal as a whole, was the Social Security Act, drafted by Francis Perkins. It established a permanent system of universal retirement pensions, Social Security, unemployment insurance, and welfare benefits for the handicapped and needy. Children in families without a father present. It established the framework for the U.S. welfare system. Roosevelt insisted that it should be funded by payroll taxes rather than from the general fund. He said, "We put those payroll contributions there so as to give the contributors a legal, moral, and political right to collect their pensions and unemployment benefits with those taxes in there. No damn politician can ever scrap my Social Security program." Compared with the Social Security systems in Western European countries, the Social Security Act of 1935 was rather conservative, but for the first time the federal government took responsibility for the economic security of the aged, the temporarily unemployed, dependent children, and the handicapped. Labor relations. The National Labor Relations Relations Act of 1935, also known as the Wagner Act, finally guaranteed workers the rights to collective bargaining through unions of their own choice. The act also established the National Labor Relations Board (NLRB) to facilitate wage agreements and to suppress the repeated labor disturbances. The Wagner Act did not compel employers to reach agreement with their employees, but it opened possibilities for American labor. The result was a tremendous growth of membership in the labor unions, especially in the mass production sector, composing the American Federation of Labor. Labor thus became a major component of the New Deal political coalition. The Fair Labor Standards Act of 1938 set maximum hours 44 per week and minimum wages 25 cents per hour for most categories of workers. Child labor of children under the age of 16 was forbidden. Children under 18 years were forbidden to work in hazardous employment. As a result, the wages of 300,000 people were increased and the hours of 13. The Overseas Highway and the San Francisco-Oakland Bay Bridge. The Rural Electrification Administration used co-ops to bring electricity to rural areas, many of which still operate. The National Youth Administration was another. The semi-autonomous WPA program for youth. Its Texas director, Lyndon Baines Johnson, later used the NYA as a model for some of his Great Society programs in the 1960s. The WPA was organized by states, but New York City had its own branch, Federal One, which created jobs for writers, musicians, artists, and theater personnel. It became a hunting ground for conservatives searching for communist employees. The Federal Writers Project operated in every state, where it created a famous guide book. It also cataloged local archives and hired many writers, including Margaret Walker, Zora Neale Hurston, and Anzia Yezierska, to document folklore. Other writers interviewed elderly ex-slaves and recorded their stories under the Federal Theater Project, headed by charismatic Hallie Flanagan. Actresses and actors, technicians, writers, and directors put on stage productions. The tickets were inexpensive or sometimes free, making theater available to audiences unaccustomed to attending plays. One Federal art project paid 162 trained woman artists on relief to paint murals or create statues for newly built post offices and courthouses. Many of these works of art can still be seen in public buildings around the country, along with murals sponsored by the Treasury Relief Art Project of the Treasury Department during its existence. The Federal Theater Project provided jobs for circus people, musicians, actors, artists, and playwrights. Together with increasing public appreciation of the arts tax policy in 1935, Roosevelt called for a tax program called the Wealth Tax Act. Revenue Act of 1935 to redistribute wealth. The bill imposed an income tax of 79% on incomes over $5. Cash and spending power in the hands of individuals. In the end, Congress watered down the bill, setting the tax rates at 7-27% and largely exempting small enterprises, facing widespread and fierce criticism. The tax deduction of paid dividends was repealed in 1938. Housing Act of 1937. Main article, Housing Act of 1937. The United States Housing Act of 1937 created the United States Housing Authority within the U.S. Department of the Interior. It was one of the last New Deal agencies created. The bill passed in 1937 with some Republican support to abolish slums. Court packing plan and jurisprudential shift. Main article, Judiciary Reorganization Bill of 1937. When Roosevelt took office, a majority of the 9 judges of the Supreme Court were appointed by Republican Party presidents. 4 especially conservative judges, nicknamed the Four Horsemen, often managed to convince the 5th judge, Owen Roberts, to strike down progressive legislation. Roosevelt increasingly saw the issue of the Supreme Court as one of unelected officials stifling the work of a democratically elected government. Early in the year 1937, he asked Congress to pass the Judiciary Reorganization Bill of 1937. That proposal would have given the president the power to appoint a new justice whenever an existing judge reached the age of 70 and failed to retire within 6 months. In that way, Roosevelt hoped to preserve the New Deal legislation, but he had stirred up a hornet's nest, since many congressmen feared he might start to retire them at 70. Next, many congressmen considered the proposal unconstitutional. In the end, the proposal failed in one sense. However, it succeeded. Justice Owen Roberts switched positions and began voting to uphold New Deal measures, effectively creating a liberal majority in West Coast Hotel Co. v. Parrish and National Labor Relations Board v. Jones. chance to appoint 8 of the 9 justices of the court. Former Supreme Court Chief Justice William Rehnquist noted that in this way the Constitution provides for ultimate responsibility of the court to the political branches of government. Recession of 1937 and recovery. Main article, Recession of 1937. The Roosevelt administration was under assault during FDR's second term, which presided over a new dip in the Great Depression in the fall of 1937 that continued until most of 1938. Production and profit declined sharply. Unemployment jumped from 143% in 1937 to 190% in 1938. The downturn was perhaps due to nothing more than the familiar rhythms of the business cycle, but until 1937 Roosevelt had claimed responsibility for the excellent economic performance that backfired in the recession and the heated political atmosphere of 1937. Business-oriented conservatives explained the recession by arguing that the New Deal had been very hostile to business expansion in 1935-37, had threatened massive antitrust legal attacks on big corporations, and by the huge strikes caused by the organizing activities of the Congress of Industrial Organizations CIO and the American Federation of Labor AFL. The recovery was explained by the conservatives in terms of the diminishing of those threats sharply after 1938. For example, the antitrust efforts fizzled out without major cases. The CIO and AFL unions started battling each other more than corporations, and tax policy became more favorable to long-term growth. Seen in an agricultural worker's shacktown, Oklahoma City, July 1939, when the Gallup Organization's poll in 1939 asked, "Do you think the attitude of the Roosevelt administration toward business is delaying business recovery?" The American people responded, "Yes," by a margin of more than 2-1. The business community felt even more strongly so. Fortune's Roper poll found in May 1939 that 39% of Americans thought the administration had been delaying recovery by undermining business confidence, while 37% thought it had not. But it also found that opinions on the issue were highly polarized by economic status and occupation. In addition, IPO found in the same time that 57% believed that business attitudes toward the administration were delaying recovery, while 26% thought they were not, emphasizing that fairly subtle differences in wording can evoke substantially different polling responses. Keynesian economists stated that the recession of 1937 was a result of a premature effort to curb government spending and balance the budget. Roosevelt had been cautious not to run large deficits in 1937. He actually achieved a balanced budget. Therefore, he did not fully utilize deficit spending between 1933 and 1941. The average federal budget deficit was 3% per year. In November 1937, Roosevelt decided that big business were trying to ruin the New Deal by causing another depression that voters would react against by voting Republican. It was a capital strike, said Roosevelt, and he ordered the Federal Bureau of Investigation to look for a criminal conspiracy. They found none. Roosevelt moved left and unleashed a rhetorical campaign against monopoly power, which was cast as the cause of the new crisis. IX attacked automaker Henry Ford, steelmaker Tom Gertler, and the super-rich 60 families who supposedly comprised the living center of the modern industrial oligarchy which dominates the United States. Left unchecked, IX warned, they would create big business fascist America, an enslaved America. The president appointed Robert Jackson as the aggressive new director of the antitrust division of the Justice Department, but this effort lost its effectiveness once World War II began and big business was urgently needed to produce war supplies. But the administration's other response to the 1937 dip that stalled recovery from the Great Depression had more tangible results. Ignoring the requests of the Treasury Department and responding to the urgings of the converts to Keynesian economics and others in his administration, Roosevelt embarked on an antidote to the Depression, reluctantly abandoning his efforts to balance the budget and launching a $5.